Where are the jelly babies? Voila. Now, there's a process eating a jelly baby. Some people start with the feet and some with the heads. For me, I prefer the heads. For some reason, it makes them taste better. I don't know why, but that's the way we just do it. Excellent.
Alan Palmer is no stranger to the world of sweets. He helped to make millions for Tribor Basset and has a unique appreciation for the appeal of these sugary treats.
I can't even tell you how many sweets there used to be, and I couldn't even try to claim that I've tried most of them, but, I mean, there were hundreds, if not thousands, of different types of sweets. There was a lot of competition on the shelf. But the process of getting them to this stage is serious business and big business.
For almost 200 years, the UK sweet business has been a profit goldmine, steeped in wondrous and creative treats.
This is what sweet shops were all about. It's just pure joy.
This business was born from endless innovation in sugar and grew a market of delicious variety. From gobstoppers to blackjacks to glacier mints, British sweets have come in an almost infinite array of shapes and sizes. But these Willy Wonka dreams soon turned into big money reality as growing titans battled for profits.
On the face of it, selling sweets is a friendly, cozy business. But in practice, it's a war.
Well, there was nothing to compare, really, was there, with Rowntree's fruit pastels or fruit gums?
High streets throughout the country were the battlegrounds in a raging sweeties civil war.
The independent newsagent was our lifeblood.
But a surprise entry from Germany changed everything.
Haribo blindsided us.
We hate Haribo. We don't like them.
Leaving the former British champions fighting to survive.
This is not a market where the meek are allowed to prosper.
This is the story of a battle for our sweet tooths. Sugar, we love it. It's not just an ingredient, its addictive charms have fueled an entire industry designed to give us one thing, pleasure.
There were small shops in pretty much every village, and the kids would rush to the shops to buy some candy after their school day. And there were hundreds, if not thousands, of different types of sweets.
Sweets have been booming since the Victorian age, spurred on by one of the 20th century's darkest events.
The Second World War came along and had a massive impact on everybody in this country. Sugar was one of the ration products, and so there was hardly any confectionery available during the war years. And in fact, right through, when rationing was lifted in the mid-50s. And then, of course, suddenly, you know, sugar was cheap again and available, and everybody wanted to buy candy and indulge.
Desperate to get the sugar fix we'd missed in years of rationing, we went sweetie mad. And the market obliged. Almost anything you could dream up seemed to exist in a golden age of sugary success.
Do you chew a sweet, suck it or crunch it, madam?
Crunch it. Well, I suck it to start with and end up by crunching it.
If it's a boiled sweet, I suck it and then chew it and swallow it. Right?
What about if it's a toffee, then?
Oh, that's got to be chewed, of course.
Whether it was bonbons, fruit salads, candy lipsticks or love hearts, British sweets were iconic.
You could look at the counter and it was filled with everything from jelly snakes to cola bottles. And for your 10p that you'd go in and you could say, I want one of those and two of those and put them into paper bags. And you came out feeling you had lots.
The first thing you notice is the colours and the contrast. Soft, hard, bright colours, multicolours. So everyone is different.
It's just the sheer variety and beauty of sweets, I think.
They've got to feel irresistible, they've got to feel light-hearted, and they've got to feel like fun.
Out of the free-flowing post-war sugar market rose two companies that had consistently created very different products. Bassetts from Sheffield, and from York, Roundtree's. Capitalising on the sugar boom, their sweets were specially selected and packaged to be instantly recognisable product brands. Sweets they hoped would make them number one in Britain's households. One of our oldest branded sweet products is the fruit pastel.
They're a special product because they've got a very strong real fruit flavour. And that recipe and method of making them has been carefully guarded over nearly 150 years now. Sweetness of the sugar, sharpness of the fruit. Quite firm, certainly not soft. Really makes you want to chew it as you start on it.
What was your favourite flavour?
Blackcurrant. Unfortunately, the first one was a green one. I still like them, but not as much.
Today we've come to the Roundtree Macintosh factory in York, and we're going inside to see. Would you like to come with me?
Roundtree Macintosh has been a giant of British confectionery for 150 years.
The confectionery operations in the UK were started by Henry Isaac Roundtree when Henry Isaac bought a cocoa business.
But in the 1870s, trouble was brewing. Roundtree's cocoa business was struggling to turn a profit, and he rapidly needed a sweet but cheap treat to offer his customers. He found what he was looking for across the English Channel.
Henry Isaac Roundtree went and found a chap called Claude Gaget, who worked in France, who made pastilles.
Roundtree persuaded the French sweet maker to secretly develop a fruity, gummy pastille to suit British tastes.
That's where Roundtree's fruit pastilles came from. They both saved the business, and they're now probably one of the longest-serving brands in the whole confectionery industry.
Roundtree's genius was keeping the process of making his fruit pastilles a closely guarded secret, one that even those in the know still can't fully share.
I mean, the old Roundtree company used to have a rule that all products had to have one difficult stage in them, so that nobody else could come in with a knockoff copy. You don't want somebody down the road making cheaper pastilles and taking your market.
Dr. Bill Edwards spent 10 years creating gummies, lozenges and boiled sweets for Roundtree's.
All sugar confectionery has sugar in it and it has glucose syrup.
He's agreed to show us the basic method for making fruit pastilles.
At this point, we're just dissolving the sugar. In a factory, you would be using a steam-heated pan. The advantage of steam heat is it's very controllable. In a fruit pastel, the secret is a solution of gum acacia. It comes from a tree from the desert in places like the Sudan. One of its properties is you can make strong syrups out of it, and that's really why it goes into sweets. It also protects the flavour of the sweet, and of course it alters the texture.
There are some elements that still remain top secret.
There are only certain things I can talk about. The confectionery industry is very, very secretive. I mean, more secrets have escaped from the places where they make nuclear weapons than have ever escaped from a major confectionery factory. At this point, I'm going to add some orange oil. With citrus fruits, you have the oil, which is in the skin, and that has a lot of the fruit flavour. Blackcurrants normally work quite well. If you try and make a banana flavour, it tends to be a bit iffy.
To give them their famous firm and chewy texture, Roundtree's pastilles have to be air-dried for 7 days.
You have like a new taste sensation? Actually quite nice. Yeah.
Roundtree's competitors never got close to copying the secret recipe. And fruit pastilles were a huge hit with the British public.
I must say, I've always thought these things are delicious, and I can't say there's anything wrong with them today. I'm going to have another one. Credit where credit's due, fantastic product. They are just the ultimate reference point for a relatively hard gum.
While Roundtree's had perfected the pastille, other iconic sweets had been created, sometimes purely by chance.
George Bassett was one of the first people to get into sweet manufacturing, and inevitably they created over the years hundreds of different products.
George Bassett's most iconic product was created thanks to one clumsy mistake in 1899.
It's called licorice. I wonder if you can guess what they're going to make.
The only Bassett salesman of the day apparently knocked over a tray of sweets when he was taking them to a customer, and the customer thought, that's a fantastic idea, let's sell them as a mixture.
All sorts were popular, but they were licorice-based, and with fruit pastilles riding high, Bassett's decided to create a fruity, gummy sweet of their own to take on Roundtree's.
We strived for texture. Wine gums are supposed to be chewy and not too soft, and they've got to have that sort of fruity flavour to them. One of the great things about wine gums, that lovely smell, which I think is the glazing wax, carnauba, I think it's called, which stops them sticking together. You can really feel it when you pick the wine gum up, and it just slightly sticks to your finger and has that very, very specific smell to it.
Roundtree sort of think that they do the best fruity flavours. What do you think about that?
Triple Bassett think they do the best fruity flavours, so I suppose it's a matter of opinion. Everybody loves wine gums, and pretty much everybody loves jelly babies as well. They were eaten by pretty much all age groups.
Bassett's wine gums were a hit and soon overtook market leader fruit pastilles to become top dog. But their rivalry through the first half of the 20th century was a very gentle affair. Both companies felt there was more than enough profit to go round.
Our competitors were really very good, and they kept us on our toes. But it's a good industry. By and large, it was quite gentlemanly.
But this green and pleasant sweetie land was about to be torn apart as a major corporation moved in, launching the opening shot in what would become a race for dominance, Mars.
Sweets are quite a ruthless business. And everybody was trying to fight the same battle as Mars, but not with the same quality of ammunition, really.
Mars Limited have built their business on what people enjoy eating, as we continue to search for new and subtle flavours to appeal to the public palate.
Mars had been a thorn in the side of British chocolate companies since the 1930s. Then in the 60s, they saw an opportunity to make a killing in sweets.
Sugar, in general, the ingredients are a bit cheaper than they are to make chocolate, and therefore there's more opportunity to make good margins, good profits on sugar products.
They just needed the right product to tempt us, and so they turned to a unique, soft American confectionery.
Sugar up till then had been largely about solid boiled sugar products, and Mars had this new sort of cloudy and opaque, soft and chewy recipe, very unlike anything else in the market.
Mars were experimenting with taffy. It's a bit like toffee, but less likely to lose you a tooth. They cooked up big vats of glucose, sugar and palm oil, allowing it to lightly set before adding juicy fruit flavours and citric acid for a mouth-watering hit.
We had these really zingy strawberry, lemon, lime flavours, which at the time I think seemed much more modern to people.
Next, they pulled out the mixture on machines, aerating it to create a smooth, chewy texture.
It was very different and it was a lot easier to eat. It produced this sort of mouth-watering effect, and that was completely new news in that market.
Launched to the sound of an unforgettable jingle, the fruit taffy would come to be called Opal Fruit, and it would refresh a stale British market.
Opal Fruits, they're so fruity, they make your mouth water.
Opal Fruits, great to make your mouth water.
The Opal Fruits tagline was describing the one thing that made Opal Fruits really different, had a high citric acid content that by definition makes your mouth water. Which gives you the sense of refreshment. And Opal Fruits did exactly what it said on the tin. But you can see they're made to make your mouth water because you can't talk whilst you're eating them. Because it's like your mouth is filling up with fruit juice, really, which is what makes them so lovely.
Throughout the 1960s, Opal Fruits went head-to-head with the likes of Bassetts and Roundtree's munching away at their profits.
Mars were the new kids on the block, and the zingy flavours were new to the marketplace. But arguably, Roundtree's products were technically somewhat more difficult to make. We didn't see Opal Fruits competing directly.
But the battle lines had been drawn. This was open warfare, and the fight soon spilled out of the factories and onto the high streets.
Mars' approach, I think, was different partly because of the style of the products that were made, but also we sold them in a very different way.
For outdated British brands, things were about to get worse. In the 1980s, the way customers started buying sweets also changed. The newsagent became the dominant sweetie retailer, promoting impulse buying that was perfect for sweets as customers added little delicious extras to their bags as they went to pay.
The real heart of the business was in those little confectionery shops, which sold newspapers and cigarettes and stuff, of course, at the time. So the product needed to be where it was tempting for people to buy, where it was no more than a slight stretch to pick it off the shelf.
In this market, Mars were the first to realise that if you wanted a buyer's attention, where you put your product really mattered.
Mars really concentrated on having a small number of products that sold really fast. So if we put our big sellers in the best display spaces, we would get the best return for our business.
Dishing out financial incentives, Mars convinced shopkeepers to put their leading products together in what they called the hotspot, the hallowed space nearest to the till. They called their strategy block merchandising.
At the time, it was absolutely a core part of how we got the edge in the market.
Mars competitors were literally edged out of the prime shelf space and saw sales plummet.
On the face of it, selling sweets is a sort of a friendly, cozy business. But in practice, it was a war. And it was primarily a war for space.
Ed Christie joined Roundtree's in the 1980s as a sales rep and was told to begin the fight back against Mars.
So there's a lot of research that's gone into what are the best positions in any confectionery display. The hotspot is here. It's obviously near the till. Clearly, the coldest spot is this top right-hand corner. And the difference in sales between a product sold in this hot spot and in the cold spot would be in the order of 1.5 to 2 times. The natural bestsellers should go in the hot spot, but Mars would offer the retailer £50 or whatever the incentive was to put all their products in a block, so they would take advantage of the best positions, regardless of how well they naturally sold.
Roundtree's knew they needed a bigger strategy to respond to this new threat or risk losing their position in the market.
They had very good merchandising operations. In truth, we could see they were getting ahead of us. We needed a new initiative that would actually get us better positions in the marketplace.
Roundtree's thought they'd found their answer with some cunning high-tech market analysis. They spent tens of thousands developing it, and if it worked, it would seriously sour the pitch for Mars.
What we wanted was something that was different and something that would benefit the retailer so that they would actually want to break up the block. And that's how merchandising by merit started to develop.
Hello. It's a well-known fact that in Great Britain, more confectionery is consumed per head than in almost any other country in the world.
My goodness, it all looks terribly familiar, but it looks slightly dated. But it shows how techniques have changed.
The company even produced a no-expense-spared video to rubbish Mars' selling tactic and promote a radically different way of looking at things.
Roundtree Macintosh weren't convinced that manufacturer block merchandising was the best way to market confectionery. They believe that this system undermines the trade as a whole and you, the retailer.
Merchandising by merit was the first time we took videos to the retailer to show them how it could be done and how he could improve his profits. And we just happened to do better as well.
Roundtree's wanted to show shopkeepers that breaking up Mars's block and putting all the top-selling brands in the hotspots would make everyone sweeter profits.
It was actually surprisingly slick, considering it's so old. I also remember the first time I saw this was in the Merchandising by Merit suite in York, and they projected on the biggest telly I'd ever seen in my whole life. That was the essence of the Merchandising by Merit logic. The merit being a good selling product should go in a good position, regardless of who actually happens to make it. It's a really clear, quite clever, logical sales pitch.
Well, there you have it.
When Roundtree's bought in Merchandising by Merit, they were very much trying to mimic what Mars had been doing, because in truth it was working for Mars, but was very, very successful for them.
If I look at stores today, so this is 30 years on from when these shelf wars were playing out, I think what Roundtree's has successfully done is disrupted the block merchandising approach. It's very rare you see all the Mars products and all the Roundtree's products merchandised in blocks. So I'm going to buy a packet of fruit pastels today, seeing as they're in the hot spots.
Thank you very much.
Cheers. Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Roundtree's had foiled Mars' attempt to dominate the sweetie shelves and had maintained their spot at the top of the leaderboard of Britain's most loved sweets. They celebrated with a quirky fun campaign highlighting the irresistible fruitiness of the product.
But you can't put a fruit pestle in your mouth without chewing it.
Gotta chew, gotta chew, gotta chew. The only thing you can do with a Roundtree's fruit pestle is chew.
But a new shadow would soon linger over the sweet maker's world, and it was huge.
Bassett Foods, who make licorice all sorts, have welcomed the £91 million takeover bid from Cadbury Schweppes. If the offer is accepted, it will give Cadbury the largest share in the chocolate and sweets market in this country.
In 1989, Cadbury, the UK's biggest chocolate maker, decided it wanted in on sweets, and it went big. Within 2 years, it had snapped up Tribor, Maynards and Bassett's to create the ultimate sugar titan.
The creation of Tribor Bassett was a game changer for the sugar confectionery industry.
Almost overnight, Cadbury had added more than six major brands to its empire, with a mammoth range of sweeties, from jelly babies to wine gums and even extra strong mints. And they had big plans to take on the market.
So we focused on four or five different products under each of those brands. We call them pillar brands.
Alan Palmer was given the job of promoting the sweet juggernaut.
The expectations were very high. And so really all of the time we were focused on growing our business and profitability.
To promote this huge range of different brands, Alan knew exactly who to turn to. Marketing expert Jaspal Chadha.
If you want to see the UK battleground for sweets, it's here.
As the battleground expanded with major retailers, his approach to boosting the company's profits would revolutionise the industry and transform the way we eat sweets.
I remember Alan Palmer saying to me, time waits for no man or woman. You have to get this done.
It's the early 1990s and Jaspal Chadha has embarked on a mission to boost sales for new mega confectioner Tribor Bassett. To tempt customers to spend big on treats, Jaspal developed an unprecedented range of bagged sweets and in the process created a new snacking culture.
No one took this as a project, as a what I call a transformational event in packaging. There's huge trends towards people traveling more. People are watching movies more. There's lots more those kind of occasions. What we were trying to do was create moments of joy. So every bag had its own sensation. And so you created effectively this family occasion where you're munching through different sweets.
Jaspal designed a range of bags for 60 of the new company's most popular sweets.
Right. So this is the bag revolution on a page. This one page captures all the tears and perspiration of launching 60-odd products in 8 months.
the retail trade moved into convenience stores, to garages, to supermarkets, and packaging for the confectionery industry had to follow that convenience requirement.
Ultimately, my aim was to create this kind of Moorishness. You can't stop because you need another one. Even in the packaging, I was loath to have resealable packaging because I wanted them to eat the whole pack. Don't save it for next time. Eat it now.
In the summer of 1991, Tribor Bassett's bagged sweets flooded onto the market, from supermarkets to corner shops to petrol stations. These shareable sensations were backed by countless humorous ad campaigns. Wine gums got the pure bonkers treatment.
Maynard's original wine gums are filled with delicious, juicy flavour just waiting to be set loose. All you've got to do is chew!
So we created advertising. It's all about joyful, fun play value, the childhood in you.
Hootsmon, there's juice loose and it this house.
The ads for all sorts played on the idea of customers being unable to resist their seductive sweet charms.
We've gone too far this time.
One too many and you might turn 30.
Capturing that emotion in brilliant advertising will get you success, no question.
All your favourite Bassett sweets in one bag. But watch out for the all sorts.
The new bags flew off the shelves, giving Cadbury's Tribor Bassett a 25% share of the market. Roundtree's were stunned by this new arrival, whose ads captured carefree childhood joy.
As the market moved that way, it was not really good for Roundtree's at the time. We didn't have products that were ideal to move into bags.
Roundtree's, by far, were our biggest competitor. But what they didn't have was the kind of diversity of products we had.
When we first put fruit pastels into bags, the tests that we did showed that we were getting a lot of bits of pastels, the sugar, rubbing off each other and falling into the bottom of the bag. So you ended up with slightly bald fruit pastels, which is not ideal in the product that we wanted to get to the consumer.
Roundtree's response was immediate, but I think they could never compete. So, no, it was good to see Roundtree suffer for once. Can I say that?
Cadbury were delighted. Between Tribor Bassett and Maynard's, they were selling more sweets than ever.
The half-pound bag range grew to something like 20% of our total business from virtually nothing in the space of 3 years.
But it wasn't long before the surging popularity of Britain's bag sweets was noticed by a sweetie giant. As the 90s rolled on, this master of confection from Germany made a bold play for British customers.
It was difficult to know whether it was going to stay or whether it would have gone. As it turned out, it's become a massive brand.
I get a cola bottle, didn't I? At Haribo, we focus really heavily on a really great tasting product with a really great texture. But more than that, Haribo is about the childlike happiness and the fun and the smile that we can put on people's faces. And I think that was the gap that we saw in the market that we could bring to consumers in the UK.
Haribo had in fact taken its first steps into the UK market during the 70s with an investment in a sweet maker called Dunhill's. This traditional producer, known for the licorice Pontefract cake, eventually gave Haribo a base from which to dazzle British taste buds with their gummy sweets.
Haribo, from its conception over 100 years ago, was making Haribo Gold Bears. So it had a long-established recipe and a history of making great quality fruit gums, which, when Haribo bought into the UK, brought those products across for the UK consumer to try.
Haribo took full ownership of Dunhill's in 1994 and started producing their famous melt-in-the-mouth gummies on site. These squidgy delights were softer than anything else the market could offer, and they were crafted using unique recipes to create colourful fruity gums and meringue-like foam. They could even combine the textures to make creative gummy mashups, and they were as cheap as penny sweets from the pick and mix.
When Haribo looked at the UK market, everyone was fixated by Roundtree's, Cadbury's, and then Mars. So effectively, it was a three-horse race. And I think the complacency set in.
Then, in 1995, Haribo changed the face of sweets with a blend of gummies tailored to the British market.
Cellmix came about because we had a really successful product range in what we call countline, or, you know, 1P, 2P, 5P sweets. And we had an idea of how we could take the most popular of those sweets and mix them in a bagged format that we could then sell through the supermarkets. And that's why Starmix is called Starmix. It's because it's the mix of the star products, the best sellers. So it's our Gold Bear, our Dummies, our Fried Eggs, our Rings, our Heartthrobs, and our cola bottles.
Combining the best of their gummy penny sweets in a popular bag, Haribo had created a phenomenon. Backed by an equally inventive ad campaign that played to pure childish fun, it sent shockwaves through the formerly cosy British market. No one was prepared.
Well, I remember Haribo coming onto the market very well. In those days, I was working in our European operations, and we'd seen them working in Germany and France. So we were quite bothered about them. Let's open this, shall we? They are brilliant at textures. Just the right amount of chew. You don't want to be forever fighting and you run out of stamina. Right? You don't want to do, oh my God, that was a tough eat. You want to make it quick and juicy. Haribo have completely nailed it. I just don't think it's particularly good, if I'm absolutely honest with you. It lacks sophistication in its taste. It's quite bland. And the chewiness, which can be seen as a virtue, is not particularly to my taste. I don't think I'd have launched this.
The gummy titan quickly built on the success of Starmix, expanding the range with more fun treats. Before long, they were dominating the UK competition. Firms like Roundtree's needed to find a way to rise to the challenge, and fast.
This is my kitchen equivalent of the sweet shop. So I have my sweets in here. Lot of Roundtree products in there. So, blackcurrant pastel, that's my favourite.
Sue Hawksworth spent 5 years heading up Roundtree's sugar brands and was their secret weapon in their bid to take on Haribo.
Absolutely gorgeous. Haribo blindsided us in a way. They effectively took the joy and pleasure of pick and mix and put it all together in one bag. So what could we do to counter that?
Sue led a team of sweet boffins that had one mission, to uncover the secret of Haribo's gummy sensations and create a sugary super sweet to fight back.
With Roundtree's, the whole benefit and premise of that brand was the real fruity flavours that we delivered, and we delivered through using real fruit juice. So at first, we thought, well, on a straight eat-for-eat basis, our products stood the test. So we created Roundtree's Fruit Pastel Body Parts.
After months of painstaking work, Roundtree's unleashed their major innovation with a unique, playful advert. But while these shapely fruit pastilles were popular, they weren't up to taking on the might of Haribo.
If I'm honest, the actual delivery of the shapes themselves weren't anything like the quality that you could get with Haribo, and that was because a pastille didn't lend itself to being moulded and formed that way.
Body Parts led Roundtree's to a key realisation.
We had to look beyond pastilles. We had to look at the soft gummy or even the foam marketplace in order to create that distinct shape.
Before they could perfect their own gummy, Roundtree's had to reconsider the basics of how and even where their sweets were made.
A soft gummy is made in a different way to a fruit pastel. Typically, those products have very rapid mould changes because they're making sweets in different shapes.
Roundtree's didn't have that expertise in the UK, but one of their factories in Eastern Europe did.
If you have got a manufacturing plant that can change moulds, change the kind of sweets that are going down, then the world's your oyster. I mean, you can make any shape, and those shapes could be as random as you wanted them to be.
Rowntree's thought they were finally onto something with a sweet that came in a variety of textures, flavours, and over 100 different shapes. They christened it Randoms.
We managed to tap into that excitement of creating pick and mix. You didn't know what kind of shape was going to come out or texture, but it had those wonderful fruity Rowntree's flavours. And they were in sharp contrast to the rather non-distinct flavours that were in a Haribo bag.
I've got a packet of Rowntree's Randoms here. Yeah, flavour's good. I think the flavour came out of them better than the fruit pastel, actually, but that's an opinion. The fruit pastel is less elastic, and the texture tends to break when you chew it in a different way. Now, they just quite a different mouth feel. It's rubbery. It breaks up more easily in the mouth. And when you squeeze it, it comes back again. And that's a typical gelatin product. It gives you an elastic sweet. Haribo have their own recipes. Their jelly sweets have got more gelatin in there, more rubbery. But that's the way they like them.
Rowntree's blasted their new hope onto the market with a decidedly random campaign. It saw those who ate the sweets speaking in randoms.
What? The crocodile hat? What's that?
Every time their fruity acorn gets that alarm clock, I want you to snowflake their teapot.
Billions of random combinations in every bag. Let your random side out with new Rowntree's Randoms.
Having managed to come up with a distinctive fruity gummy of their own, could Rowntree's match Haribo's success?
I don't think other products are Haribo-esque. I'm not sure if their product development is influenced by us or not. They certainly launched some mixed products and they launched some softer textured products into the market, which were quite different to other products that they'd launched before. But Rowntree's is a different brand to Haribo. It's offering a slightly different proposition.
I think Haribo did take notice of what we'd done with Rowntree's Randoms. It's interesting to note now that on their star mix, they declare that they now contain real fruit juices in their sweets, which was, I think, their Achilles heel versus something like Rowntree's.
Rowntree's had found their feet once again, but Haribo was about to unleash one of the biggest weapons in their arsenal. By the late noughties, Rowntree's had begun the fight back against Haribo's market domination. But the Star Mix creators have managed to stay on top using a very different type of advert.
Haribo is all about kids and grown-ups loving our products. That's our slogan. And we were looking for a new way to convey that message.
I can't be serious now.
Alison Satterthwaite has been part of the team responsible for Haribo's advertising for 10 years.
We wanted to find a new and distinct way we could really communicate the childlike happiness that the brand offers. And what better way to do that than through the voices of kids?
I just want to talk about this Haribo Star Mix Sweeties.
I like the hearts.
As soon as we had the idea of using kids' voices, we could have gone down a process which was write a script, imagine you're a child, what would a child say? But what I think people don't know or they don't recognise is that the dialogue of our adverts is completely based on unscripted conversation of kids. We got children around a table, opened up a bag of Star Mix, and asked them what their favourite sweet was and why. And that's where the magic happens.
Look, you have made a big, big sandwich.
That's really what Haribo's about.
Hey guys, who loves Haribo Gold Beer?
It was such a hit that kids' voices spread across the world.
It's been phenomenally successful for us. The campaign has now reached as far afield as the United States and most recently into Japan.
Meet there. Haribo Gold Beer.
I
rolling got more light. Oh, loads of video!
You had to be impressed by what they did. They managed to capture both kids and grown-ups and tap into that nostalgic feel. They brought out the kid in every adult, and that's been the premise of their advertising now for decades, and they did very well with it.
With the award-winning global success of their advertising and unstoppable gummies, Haribo today turns over more than £180 million a year in the UK alone and has five of the top 10 selling sweets in the country.
Did I think Haribo would become as big as they've become? No, I don't think I did. Their operations were done well, and there was some arrogance. When we looked at competitors coming in that we didn't think were quite as good, I think Haribo probably proved us that we shouldn't have been quite so self-confident.
We're much more open to new sensations. So, yes, disruptors are here to stay, and they're going to keep coming.
At this factory up in Leicester, a new brand is taking a very different approach to sweet making. As young consumers care more and more about what goes into food, Candy Kittens burst onto the market in 2012 with a key difference, making sweets with a social conscience. The company was created by TV personality Jamie Lang and designer Ed Williams.
When we first started, the whole category was archaic. You know, nothing had changed. We were still eating like cola bottles and gummy bears, and there was just nothing new and exciting.
There was this huge gap in the confectionery shelf for a brand that was really speaking to consumers of our age, people that were young, interested in the products that they were eating and what went into those products. And it just felt like it was prime time for someone to come along and challenge that.
For more than 100 years, gelatin, an animal byproduct from pork or beef, had been used to give gummy sweets their distinctive texture. Aware of their target consumers' ethics, Candy Kittens decided to remove it.
There's definitely a move towards vegan sweets. I remember when I was looking after the brands in the 1990s, that was something that continuously came up. But removing gelatin out of some sweets can fundamentally change the texture. So it's not an easy ask, and for people that is a barrier.
When we first started, people thought we were crazy. We would often get people at big established confectionery companies telling us that natural ingredients are not important, that vegan is just a fad.
Candy Kitten spent 18 months formulating the perfect recipe that could still feel squidgy and chewy in the mouth.
We wanted to make them gluten-free because we thought that would make a better sweet. But also we wanted to have real fruit juice in it in terms of blueberry juice or watermelon juice. So we wanted to make the best sweet possible. And it was always about changing that 1%. How can we get 1% better, 1% better, 1% better?
In the world of sweets, they were playing a risky game.
Launching new products in the UK is incredibly difficult. The vast majority fail within the first 3 years. And if we look back at products that were launched back in the late 90s or even in the 2010s, very few of those products you'll find on the shelves today. So it's an incredibly hard thing to get right.
We definitely had all of our eggs in one basket, and I think if it hadn't have worked, then perhaps we would have had to get ourselves down the job centre and start again.
With their innovative, ethical approach, Candy Kittens had lofty ambitions to take on the giants from the very start.
So I think one thing that Haribo do quite well is the variety of sweets in the bag. So all the different shapes are something that kind of keeps you interested and makes you rummage through. But actually, because the sweets have all been mixed together, you then don't get any individual flavours. So you struggle to tell me that that's a strawberry or that's a cola. They all just taste sweet. And one of the things we've been passionate about at Candy Kittens since day one is making single flavour bags. And then you really know if you're eating a strawberry or a cherry.
We made premium gourmet candy. That wasn't even a word until we came into the market. We invented that. We made candy premium.
But charging one of the highest prices in the industry, £3 a bag, do their own flavours cut it?
It's very different to what we do. Quite a firm texture, but it certainly delivers on the very cherry branding.
Do you think it's a little too expensive?
I think that's for the consumer to decide. Certainly it is more expensive. It's nearly twice the price of Haribo. But ultimately consumers will decide where they want to spend their money on.
Gelatin tends to make a product last longer in your mouth. And given that this hasn't got that as an ingredient, they've done very well to give it that longevity of eat. But sweets are bought for fun and enjoyment. They're cheap and cheerful, and that's what they ought to be. So whilst it might be a nice sweet, twice the price? Don't think so.
However, Candy Kitten's business is steadily growing, and they believe their influence is too.
We did a slight update onto Starmix last year. We made a slight tweak to the recipe, including more fruit juice, and we've brought new vegetarian products to market over the last 2 or 3 years as we see that popular trend continuing.
I think Haribo now have taken notice of us. To be a leader in sugar and confectionery, I think you have to be different. But it's more than that now. It's not just about what the product is, it's more about what you represent as a whole.
New companies and brands will continue to disrupt the sweet market and drive innovation.
We have a thirst for new products. I think we are desperate now as a population looking for fresh ideas and hoping those will become tomorrow's Rowntree's fruit pastels.
And the old guard of classic sweets isn't afraid to move with the times either.
They're part of our culture, they're part of our heritage. A brand like Fruit Pastel, they have stood the test of time. They have now moved to vegan. The whole market has moved. And at the end of the day, they're a damn good product.